Tell us about this new discovery.
Well, on November 2nd, Gennady Borisov, an amateur astronomer, discovered an object near the sun that is actually barely bound to the sun. So it's almost interstellar, but most likely it came from the outskirts of the solar system, the Oort cloud. That was surprising because that's around the time, the same week, that another interstellar object passed close to the sun, 3I Atlas. That one we are confident is interstellar because it was moving at 60 kilometers per second, very high speed, 600 times larger than the fastest car we have on Earth.
Whoa.
The reason I know that is because I went to a NASCAR car race where the racer put 3I Atlas on the hood of his car, and I told him that's not a big compliment for 3I Atlas because it's already moving 600 times faster than your car can ever reach. But at any event, so 3I Atlas was definitely not bound to the sun. This new object appears to be barely bound to the sun, may have come from the outskirts of the solar system, and was in a plunging orbit that got all the way close to the sun, and we just noticed it. Now, the interesting question is, could it have originated from 3I Atlas? Is it at all related to it? Because if 3I Atlas, for example, is a natural comet, it could have lost a fragment, a piece of it that was torn apart. If it is a mothership, a spacecraft, it could have on purpose released a probe into the inner solar system. So that's an interesting question. And turns out that this object has an orbit in a plane that is almost perpendicular to the plane of the orbit of 3I Atlas. So if we just use gravity to calculate its trajectory, it was definitely not related to 3I Atlas. The closest they got to each other is of order 100 million kilometers, so not very close. And so the two are unrelated. It's just a coincidence that two unusual objects showed up around the same time close to the sun. However, if it's a technological object, of course, it could have maneuvered and transited between the two trajectories that appear to be distinct from each other.
Wow. Okay, I mentioned the fact that we have asked for our viewers to kind of chime in here and ask some or pose some questions for you. 10th Crane is asking, if Atlas originated from the nearest star, how long has it been traveling?
Right, so for it to arrive close to the sun from the outskirts, the outer boundary of the solar system, that's the edge of the Oort cloud, so-called Oort cloud, it's 100,000 times the Earth-Sun separation. It took it 8,000 years to travel from there to its location right now. 8,000 years is when humans started recording their history. So 8,000 years ago is the oldest records we have of human history. So that's in cosmological terms, it's not a long time. Now we don't know where it originated, what is its parent star. It could have come from very far away, and then it took it many billions of years to arrive here. If it's a natural object, 3I Atlas, then based on its speed, it has a high speed, it could have originated from an old star because old stars, they get kicked around for much longer and they acquire larger speeds than a young star. So a calculation that I did with my student indicates that in that case, it's probably 10 billion years old, maybe 7 billion years old, older than the sun. Okay, so the star that hosted it would have been older, but we don't really know where it came from, and we don't know how high was the ejection speed of that object 3I Atlas from the parent star. So we don't know for sure the duration of its journey. If it's technological, of course, all bets are off because the question is, where are the senders? They can be very near, in which case the journey was very short. Or they can be far, and then obviously they sent it out before even knowing that we exist.
Oh, my brain is spinning like the sun or one of the planets. I don't know. But, okay. Rob here, and we're trying to get to as many questions as possible. Rob says, why don't we see more interstellar visitors considering the size of our solar system?
Oh, there. If we are talking about the visitors that arrive at random, rocks, for example, or icy rocks, then for everyone that we see in the inner solar system within the separation of the Earth from the Sun, there should be a quadrillion right now, 10 to the power 15 such objects within the solar system as a whole, going out to 100,000 times the Earth-Sun separation. The reason is simple. The volume of the solar system at 100,000 times the Earth-Sun separation, 100,000 is basically 100,000 cubed times the volume associated with the orbit of the Earth around the Sun. So for everyone you see near us, between the Earth and the Sun, there should be a quadrillion right now in the solar system. So definitely a very big number. And what it means is also that if we find one, every star should have produced a quadrillion of those if they come at random, because the volume of every associated with every star is roughly the volume that the solar system has around the sun.
There's just so much that we don't know. Just so you know, someone commented from a friend, you should be the boss of NASA. from Andre, he says, would you be happy or concerned if Atlas is a spacecraft?
Oh, I would be very happy, because I think humanity desperately needs a dose of cosmic modesty. We lack humility. We say perhaps we are at the top of the food chain in the universe, not just on Earth. We go to restaurants and eat other animals because we think that they are less intelligent than we are. We would never eat an animal that is more intelligent than we are. But of course, we can be arrogant here on Earth so far. Maybe AI systems will make us a little bit more modest. But my hope is that we would realize that we have siblings out there among the stars, and those siblings, some of them, are far more accomplished than we are. So it will teach us modesty. But on top of that, we could learn from them. It's just like learning from a smarter student in a classroom.
Well, I definitely feel like I'm in school right now from Hug. What would happen if something like Atlas were to crash into Earth?
Oh, that would be devastating. It would be similar to what happened to the non-avian dinosaurs when they witnessed a rock, an asteroid the size of Manhattan Island, colliding with Earth. They basically perished, they died. And the same kind of catastrophe would occur if Three Atlas were to crash on Earth. And gladly, it doesn't look like it's approaching very close to Earth. It will come within 100. About 250 million kilometers from Earth on December 19th. That would allow us to observe it with our best telescopes and get much more information about it. As of the last few days, we got images that show that there are more than seven jets coming out of it. And one possibility is that these jets are powered by ice, pockets of ice that is being illuminated by sunlight and warmed up, and the ice sublimates, and you end up with these jets. They go out to millions of kilometers away from the object. But another possibility is these are technological thrusters on a spacecraft. And we can easily tell the difference, because technological thrusters produce velocities that are far in excess of what you can get from some pocket of ice being illuminated, warmed up by sunlight. So we can measure the speed of those jets in the coming weeks, and then immediately know the nature of this object. So that's why science is so much fun, because it's like a detective story. We can figure out the truth by collecting clues.
So you're like the Sherlock Holmes of astronomy. All right. Miguel is asking, why are you the only scientist speaking in serious terms about what this could be?
Scientists are used to dealing with objects at great distances. For example, imagine a galaxy at the edge of the universe. It's billions of light years away. And therefore, they are used to having no consequence to what they are saying about that galaxy because it will not affect our life in any way. And that's therefore, they can just adopt the most likely interpretation and stick with it. However, when we have a visitor to our backyard, there is a risk from it. If it's technological, that it might be a threat to humanity. And we all know, I mean, governments know, intelligence agencies know that we must take seriously low probability events that could have huge implications on society. And so I regard this visit of an interstellar object as one example. Even if we assign a low likelihood for it to be technological or a threat to humanity, we must take it seriously, collect as much data as possible so we can figure out its nature and make sure that it's just a rock. And that's something that scientists don't fully understand because for them, it's just a question of what is the most likely explanation. The other thing I should say about experts is that, for example, comet experts, they are used to comets. And it's just like an AI system, artificial intelligence system that is being trained on a data set that includes only comets. So whatever the AI system says would be that related to comets. It would just say any space object is comets. That's exactly what the experts are doing. They are trained on a data set of comets. They will say anything in the sky is comets. That's their expertise. But I say to them, I say, please expand your training data set because we sent out spacecraft. Okay, so in addition to rocks, we know that in space you can find technological objects. We did it. So then, why wouldn't you include in your training data set the possibility that an object coming from outside the solar system might be technological? And they just don't get it. And they attack me and criticize me for not believing that this object must be a comet.
Okay, well, Skywatch wants to know if you think NASA's lab closures could be slowing down investigations.
Well, there was data collected on 3i Atlas when it came within 29 million kilometers from Mars. It was taken by the high-rise camera on board the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, and it's the sharpest image that we should have at this time, with a 30-kilometer resolution per pixel. And unfortunately, it happened on October 3rd, which was 2 days after the government shutdown started. And the claim from NASA is that due to bureaucratic rules, they are unable to release that data to the rest of the scientific community or to the public. As of now, we haven't seen it for 42 days. So the data exists on some computer, but they were never shared with other scientists. And I believe that this is just a result of bureaucracy overruling science. And I don't like that because I think bureaucracy should serve science, not sabotage or take hostage science. And so I think someone high up in the administration of NASA should have said, this doesn't make sense. Let's share the data. We have it. It doesn't require much work. Let's just share it at the very least with scientists because that would help them design future observations. And it didn't happen. So I'm just waiting for the government shutdown to end very soon so we can look at those images.
Yeah, well, I think we're all waiting on the government shutdown to end for many different reasons. But tell us about the Galileo project that you lead.
Right, so I started to lead it a few years ago. And the idea is that the US government, the intelligence agencies, are reporting to the US Congress that there are objects in the sky that they cannot identify. And the simplest interpretation is these are objects manufactured by adversarial nations. And therefore, it's a national security threat. That's a real issue because we put $1 trillion a year in the defense budget of 2026, and yet the Pentagon is unable to tell us what some objects in the sky are. So they are not doing their job. That's a serious matter. Now, of course, it's possible that these are not human-made objects. Maybe they came from an extraterrestrial origin, in which case it would be even more fascinating to me because I'm an astronaut. I care what lies outside the solar system. I don't care much about what humans can do here on Earth. I want to know what's outside. And of course, if it ends up that one or more of these objects are extraterrestrial in origin, that would be the most important discovery that humanity ever made, scientifically speaking. So I decided to lead a project that is constructing observatories. Right now we have three of them, and we are monitoring millions of objects on the sky every year. Starting recently, we just started to collect data in this way. And we are analyzing it with machine learning software, trying to see if any of the objects behave in ways that do not match the flight characteristics of human-made technologies. And that's what the Galileo project is about. We also had an expedition to the Pacific Ocean to collect materials from an interstellar meteor just to check if it's not a Voyager-like meteor, an object that collided with Earth that was technological. We know it was interstellar. The US Space Command confirmed that. And so we're still analyzing the materials that we retrieved there. And in addition, of course, I'm doing my research on interstellar objects like Oumuamua, the first one discovered in 2017 that looked quite anomalous, and 3I Atlas, which is very intriguing. We are still in the process of getting more data on it.
All right, only time for a couple more questions. Thank you so much for being willing to take so many questions from our viewers. They heard Avi Loeb and the questions just started rolling in here. But so as I hear it, Atlas comes closest to the Earth right around Christmas time, maybe like a week before Christmas. So even though we have folks who book interviews around here, we want to go ahead and get you on the books and to say that you'll come back.
Yeah, I will definitely do it.
Okay, all right. We will talk to you then. And I also, you mentioned, the government shutdown and the situation with NASA. I have to loop back into our last conversation where you were a little bit miffed that NASA had reached back out or the government had reached back out to Kim Kardashian before you, and you threw out a lob to Kim Kardashian. Did she reach out to
Not yet.
you?
I look forward that I will be delighted to give her all the information I know. And just illustrate how science is done. It's like a detective story. It's a lot of fun, and I'm sure Kim will enjoy it. So if she listens, I would be delighted to speak with her. I don't see myself as a member of a group of people that is privileged in academia in any way. I see myself just a member of the public, and therefore everyone is curious about this object, and we can do it together, figure out what it is based on the clues that we collect. We don't need the bureaucrats to tell us what it is. We can just figure it out the way kids do. It's really a privilege to maintain my childhood curiosity and get paid for it. That's the biggest gift that I can imagine, and that's what science brings.
Well, you are for sure certain about the fact that there are a lot of people who are curious. And just again, when we
Oh,
post that
I
you're going to
guess.
be on the show, there's a ton of people who respond. So there are a lot of people who are just as
Well,
curious as you.
the biggest reward over the past few weeks for me was emails I get from parents who tell me my daughter now wants to become a scientist.
No.
And that to me is the greatest accomplishment that I can have because surely there are many puzzles that we haven't cracked yet, and the next generation will help us get better. I believe that the future will be better than the past.
Avi Loeb, we certainly hope that. Thank you for coming on yet again, and we'll see you right before Christmas.
Looking forward to it.
Okay, we'll talk to you then. It's